So I wanted to talk about the Weil conjectures. So this is a rather deep theorem of algebraic geometry, which was first conjectured by Andre Weil, and was then the proof was finally completed by Deligne. And so this theorem relates topology of complex projective varieties to the counting of points of varieties over finite fields. And this, in some sense, is already quite exciting because these are two different things, quite different things, and the fact that there should be any relation is kind of surprising. And so I will here not make any attempt to explain why this should be true. I will just try to explain the statement, so tell you the ingredients of it, and then give some examples. So I will, this is somehow directed mostly to the, in some sense, the way I set it up towards the diploma students, so I will sometimes refer to the lectures that you had. So one of the advantages of this thing is that it somehow uses several things. It shows that the mathematics is, you know, a unity, and that, you know, you should kind of also see it as such. So, so first we talk about algebraic geometry, so let me say what is a projective variety. I'm not trying to be 100% correct. So we say we work over a field. And so we have the projective space, which you know. So this is P N over K, say. So these are just the one-dimensional subspaces of K to the N plus 1. And so in other words, these are the sets of n tuples a0 to an, where the ai are in k. Divided by an equivalence relation. Namely, we have such an n plus 1 tuple of numbers is equivalent to the same if we multiply everything by the same constant. A lambda is an element of K without zero. So for the moment, you can think that K is the complex number, so we have this. And so this is a nice space, and now we want to look at projective varieties. So for this, we take the zero set of polynomials inside this. So if F is a polynomial in n plus 1 variables, then we, which is also homogeneous, so it contains only monomials which have all the same degrees, then we can look at the zero set of F, so which is a subset of this projective space. This is just a set of all, you know, such equivalence classes, so a0 to an in this projective space, such that we get zero if we replace the variables by the ai. Okay, so this is a hypersurface in Pn. And then we can also look at the common zero set of several hypersurfaces. So if Fi are polynomials, homogeneous polynomials, then we can look at the zero set of F1 to Fl, which is just the intersection of the zero sets of the Fi. So the set where all of them are 0. And so this will be some subset in this projective space. And you know, in the algebraic geometry course, you know that such sets are called algebraic sets. And if they are also irreducible, so maybe I call this thing X. So if X is irreducible, basically means I cannot write it as a union of two smaller subsets, then it's called a variety, projective variety. Okay, so that's this. And so you can, if you want, you can always think that we have just the zero set of just one polynomial, Z of F. And in that case, the zero set of F is irreducible if F is irreducible. That means not the product of two polynomials. And you also have the notion of dimension and non-singularity, the smoothness of such varieties is defined. And you know, there's a completely algebraic definition. So the dimension, so for instance, the dimension of the projective space will be n. The dimension of the zero set of a polynomial inside the projective space will be n minus 1. And you have non-singularity or smoothness, which means whatever, that the tangent space at every point has the same dimension as X. And for you have an algebraic criterion for that. For instance, the zero set of F in Pn is non-singular if and only if there is a, if I take the zero set of F and all its partial derivatives, is empty. Okay, this is a completely algebraic criterion. This you had, I think, in your course. So now we want to look in particular at complex projective varieties and manifolds. So in the algebraic geometry course, usually when you do algebraic geometry, you use you have these varieties with the Zariski topology, and this is all very strange. But if you have a variety over the complex numbers, you can also view it as a complex or differentiable manifold by just taking the same set in the projective space and using it with the usual topology. So we have that if X in PnC, let's say that is a smooth, so non-singular, projective variety. Say, so maybe I put a large n here of dimension n. So then I claim this is a differentiable manifold, like in the course that students had. So first thing is that the projective space P and C is a 2n-dimensional differentiable manifold. And it's kind of obvious. If I have a point, if I have look at the set A0 to AN, such that in PN, such that, so this was large N, such that A0 is different from 0, so then this is a chart, diffeomorphic to C to the n, which is the same, which is for this purpose the same as r to the 2n, just in the obvious way, I send this thing to a1 divided by a0 until an divided by a0. And so we, if we do this for the other AI, we get all these charts, and this makes it into a differentiable manifold. And if our x is supposed to be a smooth projective variety inside this thing, then x, just a subset x, will in a natural way is a submanifold of dimension 2n. When n, so we always talk about real dimensions here. So, okay. So, let's look at some examples. If we take a one-dimensional projective space over the complex numbers, you know, one can describe this. We have the open set where the first coordinate, the zeroth coordinate, is non-zero, which is isomorphic to C, and we add just one point at infinity. And so this is really just the one-point complexification of that. So it will turn out that this, as a topological space or as a manifold, is just S2. So it looks like this. Then we can also look at an elliptic curve. So let's say C contained in the two-dimensional projective space should be an elliptic curve. So that means it's a non-singular variety, which is a zero set of a homogeneous polynomial of degree 3. Non-singular cubic. Then one can show that it will be a torus. So it looks like this. Okay. And more generally, if you look again at torus, so if instead C in P2C is the curve, a non-singular curve of degree D, zero set of a homogeneous polynomial of degree D in three variables, then it follows that C is a Riemann surface of G, where G is equal to D minus 1 times D minus 2 divided by 2. So it looks somehow like this, as such handles. Okay? So we see that these are some nice manifolds. So now I want to talk about this because I want to talk about the topology of our complex projective variety viewed as a manifold like that. So, and what we want to look at of it about is the homology. So the students had a course in algebraic topology where homology was introduced. So if X is a topological space, reasonable one, then we can associate to it the homology groups. Maybe I call them just HI X. And maybe as coefficients, I take just the rational numbers. So this is a vector space over Q. And it's a bit complicated to say what the homology. So we can somehow associate to our topological space some groups or some vector spaces, which somehow tell us something about the shape of X. So very roughly, we could say that the dimension of this vector space should somehow have something to do with the number of e-dimensional holes, so i-dimensional holes, of X, whatever that might mean. So for instance, if we have something which consists of two kind of blobs like that, then we will have, and you know, and this itself is just an open subset of two, each of them, then we will find that you know, it has two components, and this will imply that H0 of this will be equal to Q squared, namely one factor for each connected component. And if we have something like a circle, so then we get H1 of the circle will be equal to Q, corresponding to the fact that this thing has a hole in the middle which does not divide the thing, but you know, somehow does that. And H0 in this case will be also Q because it's one piece. And so on, whatever that means. But obviously, this is not a definition. So I, in your lectures on algebraic topology, you had some introduction of homology. I think it was simplicial homology. So I will very briefly review how that goes. Obviously, I cannot do it properly because it's a course if one does it properly. So, so there are many different definitions of homology, which are for nice spaces give the same groups. But for the simplest one, even though not the simplest one to work with, is the simplicial homology. And it works very simple. We divide our topological space X into simplices. This is the first step. So that means you have points, edges, triangles, tetraeders. And we somehow, actually, we will use oriented simplices. So somehow, so the point is a point, so we count it positive. Now, one can imagine an orientation of an edge to be like a direction, and this will be the same as minus if you do it the other way around. Or if you have a triangle, you can view an orientation somehow as a way of turning it around, and this will be the negative of turning of somehow the other direction. In the course, obviously, you have a proper definition which somehow has to do with numbering the edges and the vertices. But for these small dimensions, it somehow seems to me more intuitive to just write this. And then we can make, so we have our X and we have divided it into simplices. For instance, we have this very simple case. We have this thing we have divided it into. So we have here, so these are maybe our points. So we have two triangles, this and this. And maybe we give it an orientation. So whatever. Give all of them an orientation, whatever, for instance, like this. And now we make a chain complex. I don't know why it's so difficult. Chain complex. So we have some vector space CK associated to our X. We have divided into triangles like that, which is just the direct sum over all sigma oriented case simplices. And we take the vector space Q times the simplex. So we have a vector space which has dimension as many as the number of case simplices. For instance, C2 in this case is a two-dimensional vector space. And we have a boundary map. So we have now, for each K, we have this. And we have a boundary map between different ones. Which is, delta from CK to CK minus 1, which is is a vector space homomorphism, so Q linear. So the coefficients, on simplices itself, it's given like that. If we take a point, this is mapped to 0. If we have an edge with the two endpoints like this, maybe I call this is number 1 and this is number 2, this would be, and say it's oriented like this, then this will be minus the starting point plus the endpoint. And for a triangle, we just take again the edges with the orientation given by this. So this is, say, this one plus this one. Okay? And so this gives us a map. I don't tell you how it works for higher K, because then you would again have to, cannot rely on this intuition anymore with this little drawings. And you can check if you apply delta twice, you get the zero map. And so you can define the kth homology group of X to be the kernel of the vector space homomorphism from CK to CK minus 1 divided by the image under delta of CK plus 1. By this statement, this thing is a subvector space of this one, and this will be our vector space, which is the homology. So one has this definition. It's not quite clear what this should have to do with holes, but you can, if you experiment a little bit with small cases, you can somehow see where it comes from, that somehow it has something to do. If you have a hole, this will, you somehow can have a K-cycle which goes, so something which is in the zero which goes around it, and you can only fill it up, which then would mean that it is in the image here, if the hole is actually is not a hole. Yeah. So just to say it, if you have a triangle like this, but just the outer side, then this delta of this will be zero. But it will be delta of this. Delta of this will be zero, but this is equal to delta of this. Okay? And so therefore, you can see that you will get a non-trivial group if this thing is empty, but if you can close it up, then you don't. And so it has something to do with holes. Okay, so much about that. So once one has these things, these groups, we can look at the Betti numbers. I'm a bit slow. So bi of x is just the dimension of the ith homology group of x. And we have the, so we just take this number, which is the dimension. So we throw away some information, and we have the Poincaré polynomial. Which is just a polynomial which keeps these numbers. So this is, say, P of xt, sum over all I, the ith Betting number of x, t to the I. So knowing this polynomial is the same as knowing all the Betting numbers. So just in our examples, maybe we'll not explain it, but for instance, we get, if we take the Poincaré polynomial of S1, according to what I told you, this is 1 plus t. If we take the Poincaré polynomial of S2, which is the same as, you know, obviously, so I had a t as a variable here, p of the projective space over C, one dimensional t, this is 1 plus t squared. And if I have a surface of, say, genus G, such things, then we will get 1 plus 2g times t plus t squared. So the dimension of the first homology group is 2g. In particular, for torus, we get 1 plus 2 plus t squared, because g is equal to 1. So now, so much for the complex thing. So I've explained one side of the theorem, which I haven't told you. And now I will tell you the other side, which is somehow counting points over finite fields. So for this, to count points of, so if we start with a complex variety, if we want then to count points of a variety over a finite field, we somehow have to make out of the complex variety over a finite field, over the complex numbers 1 over a finite field. And this we do by reduction modulo p. P is a prime. Like 2 or 3 or 5 or 7. But we do it, so let X in complex projective space, say maybe we do it like this, be a complex projective, a smooth, non-singular complex projective variety. As I explained before. And we require that it is defined over Q. What does that mean? So we know that X is the zero set of some polynomials. That's what it means to be a projective variety. And we want that the coefficients of these polynomials are in Q. So if that is the case, we say that X is defined over Q. Now, if it is defined over Q, it's in some sense also defined, so over the rational numbers, it's also defined over the integers, because once we have coefficients in Q, we can multiply, we can clear all the denominators of the FI, and we get polynomials with coefficients in Z. And we can also do this in such a way that afterwards, the coefficients are relatively prime. Okay? So then clear denominators. Then we have that the Fi are polynomials with coefficients in Z. As I said, I want them to be relatively prime. So once we have that, we can reduce modulo P. So we have the finite field Fp. So we have the Fp, which is just Z modulo Pz, is simplest finite field where P is a prime number. So this as a set is just the set from 0, 1 until P minus 1. And then, as you know, you add things here by adding these numbers and then taking the rest by division mod p, and you multiply them by multiplying these numbers and then taking the rest by division mod p. So this is a nice field. And so we have our fi with coefficients in z, so we can take fi bar to be the so the polynomial obtained from f by reduction modulo p. So we have this has some coefficients ai, and we just take for each coefficient we just take the rest that we get when we divide by p, replace it by that, so we get a polynomial with coefficient in fp. Okay, that's very simple. So we have associated to our complex variety with this assumption a variety over a finite field, and actually fp. Now, we haven't yet, but obviously it's the obvious thing is that x bar, we take just the zero set of these polynomials, which is a subset in the projective space over this field fp. Now, note that, so this is the reduction of x mod p. It's a rather simple thing. And now we want to, so thus we have associated to a complex projective variety, a variety over a finite field, over this field fp. And we want to count the points. So note, if we take this projective space Pn over, So obviously, we also, I write this maybe xfp. We also have if q is a prime power, you know that the finite fields have as number of elements the powers of primes, and these are all finite fields. So if q is a power of p, then this we also have the finite field. So we have fq is a finite field. It was mentioned in the algebra course, and so if you want, so this is a field extension of fp. It's actually a splitting field of a certain polynomial over fp. So we have studied that, and it has, you know, p to the n elements. So anyway, we have that fp is a subfield of fp to the n. So therefore, we can also look at the zero set of the same polynomial in fp to the n. Okay, so we can also have x bar fp to the n, which is just the same zero set of the same polynomials in the projective space over fp to the n. And now we want to count the points of these things. So count the number of points of x over fp to the n. So was it x? of x bar over fp to the n. So we should remember that, you know, the projective space of any dimension over a finite field is finite because it's a quotient of just, you know, the n plus one dimensional vector space over fp. So it certainly has finitely many elements. And this is this points of this variety are a subset, so it's certainly finite. And we want to count it. And so we write down a generating function. The generating function is a formal power series which contains all these numbers. This is called the zeta function of x. So this would be, so let's say x, so we take z, our prime number of x comma t is a variable. So what we do is we write down for all n bigger equal to 1 the number of points of x over fp to the n, some nice number. Then to make it more complicated, so we make a generating function like this. To somehow confuse the issue even more, we take the exponential. So exponential just means the usual thing. So the exponential of a formal power series, so of a variable x, is just the formal power series sum n bigger equal to 0 x to the n over n factorial. And as you see, the thing inside here is a power series starting with t, so certainly we can do this to this power series to get a formal power series. Okay? This is this generating function. For instance, to see what this exponential does, if I take, I can call this exercise, although it's trivial, if I take the exponential of, say, sum n bigger equal to 1, alpha to the n, t to the n over n, this will turn out to be 1 over 1 minus alpha times t. So it's the power series which is the development of this rational function. You know, this just comes from the fact that this thing inside basically is the logarithm of this. No? And so then you take the exponential. So we can therefore, we can use this to write down one example. So what is the zeta function of P1? So I claim, so where do I have it? So so we know that P1 over a field K can be written as K union the one point infinity. So in our case, over FQ, we have here FQ and one more point. So we see that the number of points of P1 over FQ is equal to Q plus 1. Okay? So if we write this zeta function here, we get, therefore, this is the exponential of sum n bigger equal to 1. So 1 plus p to the n, t to the n over n. Now, the exponential is multiplicative. So it's the exponential of this first thing with the 1 and the 1 with the p to the n. And to both of these, this applies. So according to the exercise, this is equal to 1 over 1 minus t times 1 minus p times t. So it's actually relatively simple. In particular, we see it's a nice rational function. And so now I want to say that this somehow always happens, and in a very interesting way, which is related to the topology of the variety we are talking about. So this is the theorem, A conjectures. So let's say X, smooth projective variety of dimension n over the complex number. And so we assume that the reduction, and it should be defined over C, defined over Q. It also works if, well, anyway, we'll not come to that complication. So defined over Q. And we assume that the reduction mod the prime P is also non-singular. Mod P. So the reduction mod P is non-singular. Then we have the following result. First, this thing, this zeta function, is a rational function. So ZP of X T can be written as a rational function like that. So we have some polynomials with odd indices, Q1 of T, Q3 of T, and so on until Q, 2n minus 1 of T. This is a polynomial, and then below we have even indices, Q0 of T times Q4 of T, and so on until Q2n of T. Okay, where these qi are polynomials with complex coefficients in T. What? Yeah, that's Q2. They are just the even numbers. There's no further complication. So these are this, and one can actually say one of them, two of them are particular zero, particular simple. Q0 of T is just one minus T. And Qn of T is just 1 minus Q to the n, T. You can see that, for instance, the case of P1, we are in this instance where we have only these two. So you have only Q0 and Q2, and it fulfills this thing. And what else can we say about these polynomials? That is then the more interesting part. namely, we can, you know, we are over the complex numbers, we can somehow factorize these polynomials. So we can write Qk of T. We can write this as a product over some I. I will soon say more about this I. 1 minus some complex number alpha ki times t. So the, okay, where the alpha ki are some complex numbers. And they have one interesting properties. These are complex numbers, so I can take the complex absolute value. And this will be equal to P. Here I have worked over ZP. So everything is over P, so this Q becomes a P. Okay? So this would be P to the K halves. And what else can we say? Now comes, this actually is very deep, but the thing which in the moment interests us more, that we actually can see what the index is. The index goes from I equal 1 to the kth Betti number of x over the complex numbers. So this is very amazing. So that means the degree of this polynomial qk of t is equal to the kth Betti number of xc. And, you know, this is really quite amazing because, you know, it doesn't look like there's very much relation between counting these points and the topology of this thing. And, you know, okay. And the last thing, which I'm not sure we will use, is that there's actually some relation between these different polynomials. Namely, if I take Q 2n minus k, so it goes until 2n of t, this can be written as the product. Again, I equals 1 to bk. Of p, so 1 minus p to the n times alpha ki. So this is something which is related to Poincaré duality for manifolds. I don't think you know that, but anyway, there is a further property that this thing has. But you can see this in particular, as you see, implies that bk and b2n minus k are equal, and this is Poincaré duality, which one knows from algebraic topology, but maybe not in a beginning course like that. Okay. So what one can easily check, that one can reformulate this in a simpler way. So this formula, one and two, we can reformulate in a different way. So one and two are equivalent to the following. If we just take the number of x over, so x bar over fp to the n, then we can write this as the sum k from 0 to 2n, sum I equals 1 to the ith Betti number of the our complex variety, minus 1 to the k times alpha k I to the n, where the alpha ki are the same as we had here. So this is just, you know, if you think of it, it's just, again, applying this exercise. You know, it's really an exercise that these two statements are equivalent. But what this tells us, however, is that if we count the number of points over these fp to the n, for all of them, then we can determine these numbers. I mean, we can determine the terms in this formula, and we can read off the Betti numbers. We just have to see, you know, when we know all these numbers, we know what the alpha I are, and we have to count how many alpha I have absolute value p to the power k halves. This is the kth Betti number of our variety. Okay, so thus can read off the Betti numbers, or if you want the Poincaré polynomial of our complex variety from the number of points over fp to the n, if we know it for sufficiently many n. And in particular, simple case, so if we are in the case that this is very, very simple, that the alpha I are just powers of P. So if number of x over, say, f, so q is p to the n, is a polynomial say g of q, then it follows that the Poincaré polynomial of xc, we have to count the things where we have the power p to the k halves, so we just replace q by t squared. Okay. But in general, we don't need that, so even if it's not like that, we can do things. Okay. So I want to give some examples. So I should say, so for one thing, it's exciting that this strange connection is there between complex geometry and counting points. But it's also actually useful. It has been applied. So the field of algebraic geometry I'm working in is moduli spaces. So moduli spaces are varieties which parameterize something we are interested in. Okay? So the points of the thing corresponds to certain objects, say vector bundles, curves, whatever. So then usually you can prove that such a moduli space exists, and maybe you can prove it's non-singular and projective, but maybe you cannot say very much about its shape, but you know what its points are. So therefore, you can count the points. So without knowing anything more than the existence and the kind of smoothness, you can compute the cohomology of the space. You have no idea how it looks like, but you can still find out what its shape is by just counting points. So let's look at some examples of such moduli spaces. In some sense, for instance, if you take the n-dimensional projective space, so if we take this over FP, FQ, so this is just parameterizes the one-dimensional subspaces of FQ to the n plus 1. And so we choose a basis vector. So this is, we have FQ to the n plus 1. We take a non-zero vector, and we divide by multiplying by a constant. We have equivalence classes now of n tuples non-zero divided by this. And so this means if we take the number of points, this will be, so this has q to the n plus 1 minus 1 points. And this has q minus 1. So we get q to the n plus q to the n minus 1 plus and so on plus 1. So we get this. So this is a polynomial in q. So according to the story, we get that if we take the Poincaré polynomial of Pn, this is just say whatever t to the 2n plus t to the 2n minus 2 plus and so on plus 1. And in fact, it's kind of well known that the homology of P2 has a 1 is z in every even degree. And so this is over the complex numbers. And so we get this. Let's look at this somewhat more complicated but related example. Which is the Grassmannian. So So this is a projective variety which parameterizes, so G, I call G Ln. So this will so over any field, this will parameterize the L-dimensional subspaces. Of k to the n. So the projective space is just g1 n plus 1. So how can we count points? So we want to compute the number over a finite field fq. So how does it go? So if we want such a subvector space, so it's a subvector space, no? We first can choose a basis for the subvector space. So first, the basis for the subvector space V of dimension L. So we choose just L linearly independent vectors. How does it go? So the first vector, we can just choose any non-zero vector. So we get q to the n minus 1. So this is v1, is an element in k to the n without 0. Then the second vector, we can take any vector which does not lie in the span of this. So this would be q to the n minus q. So the v2 is an element in k to the n minus the span of the first vector. And obviously you can see how it goes on. So we get in the end q to the n minus q to the l minus 1, because our last vector, vl, is an element in k to the n, so k was fq, without the span of the first l minus 1, which is in L minus one dimensional vector space. And then we have to forget the basis. So we just want to remember the vector space. So if we have two bases of the same vector space, so if V1 to VL spans same space as W1 to WL, they are both bases of a L-dimensional subvector space, then this is like this if and only if. There exists a matrix, which is also then unique, an L by L matrix, which kind of transforms one basis into the other, so such that Wi is equal to sum over all j, aij times vj for all I from 1 to L. That's how it goes, so we can change the basis, and this will be. So we have to count how many such matrices there are. But if you think of it, if you have a matrix, the first, you know, an L matrix of rank L, obviously. It should be a matrix of full rank. If you take the first column of the matrix, it's just a non-zero vector from K to the L. The second one is a vector from K to the L from the, you know, from the complement in K to the L of the one-dimensional subvector space generated by the first one, and so on. So it's the same story as here. So the number here, matrices, is Q to the L minus 1 times Q to the L minus Q times, and so on, Q to the L minus Q to the L minus 1. And so we find that the number of points of G Ln over FQ is what we obtain if we divide this thing by that, and we can kind of factor out the extra factors Q that we have here So we will get that this is that this is just anyway, it seems obvious, q to the n minus 1 times q to the n minus 1 minus 1 times q to the n minus l plus 1 minus 1 divided by q to the l minus 1 q to the l minus 1 minus 1 until q minus 1. And so thus it means if we want to see what is the Poincaré polynomials, what are the Betti numbers of this Grassmannian, of which we don't know anything else than that it exists and that it parameterizes these things, and I claim it's also non-singular and so on, the Poincaré polynomial over of this thing over the complex numbers will be this thing where we replace the q by t squared. So this is t to the 2n minus 1, and then it goes on until so the 2n minus l plus 1 divided by 2l minus 1, and it goes on in the same ways here until t squared minus 1. And if you are familiar with some combinatorics, you can, so a priori it's maybe not completely obvious that this is a polynomial, but you can easily check that it one factors by the other. And and so we know that the by this thing, the odd Betti numbers of this thing are zero, and the even ones are given by this formula. So if I take the 2kth Betti number of this thing, then you can read off with some effort from this formula. I will not, call it maybe an exercise, that this will be equal to the number of partitions of our number k into, if I'm not mistaken, n at most n minus l parts, and and all of which are smaller, which are each of which is smaller or equal to l, smaller or equal to l. So you divide, so partition means just you write the number k as a sum of smaller numbers, and I require that I should have at most n minus l numbers, and each number should be at most l. And for instance, the first non-trivial case is a G2-4, so when it's not a projective space in this case, we get the Poincaré polynomial of this thing will be 8 plus t to the 6 plus 2 t to the 4 plus t squared. Okay, so I used up my time. I wanted to say also something else, but maybe I will not. So maybe that was all I wanted to tell you for now. Thank you very much. I hear you.
Any questions without a microphone?
When I do this thing, I do the reduction modulo P. inside this finite field, but it has nothing to do with the real parts. I mean, the points over the finite field do not lie in this other one, because you know you reduce modulo p, so it's not so you cannot see it in this way. Yeah, I said it in the beginning, maybe I didn't write it. So the conjecture was maybe made in the 40s, and it was proven, I think, 74 or something. By the proof was finished by Deligne 74. It got the Fields Medal for that. There had been work on that for many years by Grothendieck and others to set the basis, but it's but it has been proven for quite some time. Yeah, but it somehow it's always called the Weil conjectures because it, in spite of because it's not the Weil theorem because he didn't prove it. He proved it for curves. And then conjectured it in general. No, I mean, I was. No, but you know, I understand that. I mean, I was, I was trying to say it in a simpler way. But yeah, good. So the correct word is good reduction mod p. I just said, pretended that that meant it's just smooth. But I somehow, okay. But I don't know. It's maybe a bit complicated to say what good reduction precisely means. So, but it roughly means that it's non-singular. Oh. So certainly it must be non-singular of the correct dimension and. Maybe it should be irreducible and whatever. But anyway, so it's okay.
All of this required.
Yeah.
So the model.
Well, I require that the model is, but if you have a natural. So.
Or how do you make sense of.
Yeah, so this is just for simplicity. So the whole thing works also when it's not defined over Q, over the rationals. It's a bit more complicated. So if your variety is not defined over Q, but just like that over C, you have some polynomials, then you can look at the field which is generated by the coefficients of the polynomial. So this is a finitely generated extension of the rationals, and then you can look there. You can find some residue field which is a finite field of characteristic p. And then you work with that. So to do it, just that I can work with fp like this and just reduce mod p. For this, I need to that is defined over q, but I don't actually practically need it. But obviously. When you have a naturally defined moduli space, most of the time it will be defined over a rather small field because it's naturally defined. But for instance, if you take the Hilbert scheme of points, it will be defined more or less over the same field over which the variety was defined. And so then obviously you cannot make such assumptions and you have to, to do this thing. You take the field generated by the coefficients and then you reduce, a finite field, which is a residue field of that. If you do it in a suitable sense, quasi-projective is enough. Maybe one has to know what one means by the Betti numbers. Then I think you might be getting the Borel-Moore homology or something like that. It certainly makes also sense then. In fact. Well, no, maybe I will not say that.